Hi, I'm Alex, and I'm a real estate broker in New York. I'm here to talk about what it takes to buy your first home. First thing, the most important thing is to find out how you're financially capable. The first thing you need to do is really check on your credit, which means that you should have a credit score of 700 or above. Usually most banks want you to have at least 3 credit cards and to be used, not just to possess them. There are so many websites that you can go to, check on yourself and not tell anybody. Keeping up with your credit cards, your car payment, whether it be school loans, it could be anything that is attached to you. You want it where you don't touch your credit enough, you know, a lot, pay your bills, and don't be late. Second thing is, find out where do you want to live. Do you want to live in the city? Do you want to live in the suburbs? Before you even go out to find an agent, find out where you work, the commute, and to make sure that you can keep where your distance of where you're not living in your car or transportation. Second thing is also the style of your home. Do you want like a small little cottage, a brownstone, or do you want to be in a co-op versus a single family home? Do all your homework ahead of time by looking at styles. I give a summary sheet and something that basically helps you get there before you meet me at a showing at a house is all these facts that you want to make sure you give me so I don't waste your time, that I actually know what you're looking for. How many bedrooms, how many baths, you want a man cave, you want a lady cave, you want something where you, things are the most important things is always have your punch list with your agent. As a real estate agent for first-time home buyers, I always try to make sure I understand really where you are, like financially, getting a pre-approval so that I don't have you get disappointed. That's the most heartbreaking thing is to find out after you found your dream home that you can't afford it. To find out by getting a pre-approval is to go to either your local bank that you have your money in, or you go to a commercial bank, which is basically a mortgage broker. But if you, for instance, don't have money saved, because today, as you know, an average home on a single family home is $400,000 and up. So a single family is just kind of where you have land and a house, and you pay taxes towards it, towards the school, the county, the town, it could be anything. A condo is a building, and basically it is an apartment, but at the same time, in that apartment, you own the building in itself, where you are responsible for the taxes for the building, the upkeep, which is the common charges. Then you have a co-op, a cooperative, which is a don't own the land, you don't own the building, but you have a share with all the people that own that building. But it's just really an easy way to start your way up the ladder on ownership. Finding a real estate agent, that is important. Find a full-time real estate agent. Somebody that does this for a living, and that's all she wants to know is real estate. And that's where I came in for many, many years doing real estate, is that I educate my clients from the beginning to end and carry them through the process. I don't wait until 5 o'clock at night. We talk during the day, the weekends. So find an agent that specializes on where you want to live, the style of their home, that they can start their homework for you. Finding a real estate agent is where you want to make sure that person is educated on what's happening in the community and the costs, and be able to do their due diligence to make sure that if you find a property that you really, really love, that she will do all the fiduciary duties of taking care of that house being what it says on the paper. So make sure your real estate agent just doesn't just say, here's your listing, go to the open house, tell me what you're thinking. Have an agent that goes with you and enjoys the time that they know at the end you're gonna find your dream home. A mortgage is where, it's when you go to the bank, when you go to get a mortgage, it's taking the sale price of the home, what you're buying the home for, like that's what you want, and then whatever your down payment is. On a mortgage, there's a thing called PMI. If you can't put up 20% of the down payment on a mortgage, there's a private mortgage insurance tax. Well, it's a penalty that will be included in the mortgage. So a mortgage is an amortization chart. So basically it's taking the interest rate that the mortgage you're taking on the house. So you're buying a house of $500,000. You're putting down $100,000. This is hypothetical, $100,000. So you have a $400,000 mortgage. So you're putting 20% down, which is great. So you don't have the PMI. And then that whole process of where it's interest first, which could be at now 5%, and then what you're borrowing. And then it's branched out, and most people who are getting mortgages have a 30-year mortgage. So it takes a whole process of going 30 years on an amortization chart. So it's taking the interest, the principal of what you're borrowing, and spreading it out 30 years. So it looks really bad at the beginning because you're paying more interest towards the purchase of the home, which you're borrowing, and then it dwindles and goes down by 30 years. Pre-approval is when you go to the bank, to the mortgage broker or the commercial bank, and have them go over your financial statements of who you are. Basically, what they're gonna want is 2 years of your tax returns. They're gonna wanna see your pay stubs for at least a month. They're gonna wanna know what your debt to income ratio is, because when you get a pre-approval, they're gonna put all those into a formula, and that's gonna be based upon the sale of the home and also to the taxes. You might find a house for $500,000, but the taxes are $15,000, but you only make $85,000, and you might have $1,500 a month in debt. So they gotta pay your income to against all your bases of your debt to make sure that they also include the taxes to say it's gotta be about 30%. You can't go over 30% of your debt to income. Otherwise, you're gonna have to find a home that is $500,000 for a pre-approval, but your taxes have to be under 12. And some condos have, and co-ops have, common charges, which you gotta include into the taxes too. So all those things that have to do with a pre-approval when you go there, always make sure when you make the appointment, you bring all the information, show them your tax returns, make sure that you give them what exactly you have in debt. Don't find out when they have to do a credit check on you and find out, oh, you didn't tell me about this debt you had and you forgot about it. That will bring you sad in the sense because you can't find that home. So make sure you're, when you go to the bank, you bring all this information to the bank. On a listing, for instance, if you have you see one that says pre-foreclosure, it doesn't mean that that house is in foreclosure. It means that the homeowner has defaulted a couple of months. It's not a warning sign for the buyer, for instance, for you. But if you find a home that says a short sale means is that the bank and the seller, the homeowner, have come to an agreement that they're saying, yes, you have defaulted on your home, you can't afford your home, you want to walk away with good credit, so we're trying to help you out by selling it together to pay off your debt. And that means it's a timing. So when you see a short sale, it means that there's a three-party situation. It's a bank and the homeowner, and you basically have to move quickly so that person doesn't go into foreclosure if you've loved that home. A foreclosure is buyer beware, because that home gives you no warranties. The seller and the bank says, take this house as is. We're not gonna tell you whether they owe mechanic liens. And a mechanic lien means that maybe they had a plumber there. Maybe they had a roofer there and they never paid them. That plumber, that roofer, will put a lien on that house, and whoever buys it has to pay it. if it's in foreclosure. If it's taxes that are owed and the bank hasn't paid them because the bank hasn't gotten any money from you and they're just putting their hands up, you own it. You pay it as the buyer. So a foreclosure is something where you might walk into that house and sometimes they won't even let you in the house. You have to buy that house at an auction, looking out the outside and projecting what could be inside, which could be that they might have taken the pipes out, the electric, but the copper. Copper is, you know, they want to get the copper out of the house. The appliances are missing. Things in that house could be even burst pipes. Foreclosures, everybody thinks that's the steal of the century. Oh, get the house for, you know, for practically for nothing. I work with a lot of people who are flippers. And what happens with them is that they have to understand they're ready to go in at any expense, knowing the neighborhood, for instance, and say, I'll take the chance. But a first-time home buyer, that in itself is like the money pit. You will regret it. Unless you're a seasoned buyer and this is not your primary residence and this is not something that you can, you know, lose money. You know, sometimes you can lose money because you could be the prettiest house in the worst neighborhood and you'll never get your money return on that. Well, I hope you enjoyed what I've given you here on information on how to buy your first home. And if you should need me for anything, I'm there. My name is Alex Nymphius. And I know there's so many of me out there, but at the same time, do your research, enjoy the journey, and have fun on just enjoying the concept of being a homeowner. It's fun.